very difficult, very challenging to have the venues free from cars. So this is one thing which definitely is there and which might not be like thought about. As far as game and the strategy and the policies are concerned, SE is working quite considerably. Like they have got Tournament Express buses, they have got metro buses, they've got various modes of transport to carry spectators from different fan zones, hotel sites, to the stadiums. And on top of it, as you have seen in the London Olympics, there might be a game lane, basically. And that game lane can be an express lane to be used by the buses only. If you are driving your car, even if you are in the taxi, you won't be able to use the game lanes to come to the stadiums. So there are things being thought about, and I think SC is definitely working in these areas to make this World Cup as green as possible, rather than like everyone driving out to the venues, because at venues there are parking spaces has been deliberately pushed out of the stadium precinct. Like you're not allowed to come into the stadium precinct, and stadium precinct and the parking spaces might be a kilometer. But then from your parking point you can jump into a bus, the shuttle bus can take you and drop you to the nearest Magen Bag area where you can just do your Magen Bag. So there are measures being taken, there are policies being taken. Yes, it will be challenging, but I think it's all been well thought of. It has been considered.
Also, I'd just like to add one important thing that the SE is also working with the FIFA on to reduce congestion and to help with the first question about traffic management is to try to schedule the games so you don't have two games in nearby stadiums at the same time. So if you have one in a Rayyan stadium, you won't have one in Vacation City at the same time, which means that the traffic will spread throughout the day for that concept. That's still yet to be approved by FIFA. That's one of the ideas that they are working on.
I just wanted to give two examples just to show how we could really make people go toward using public transportation system. One example is about developers or urban planning for the cities. And I give an example of Education City, where they built the city where in the buffers of the cities there are major car parks. And then within these major car parks, there is a light rail system that could take you to any building you need to go to within the city. It does not give you a chance to go with your car and going inside and roaming around. So that's the way that the design of the city was done to encourage people to use the system. Another thing is the convenience. Well, if you do me a rail that takes me in the middle of the mall and I would avoid being in traffic for hours, if you touch on me in London, I won't use the car if I have the Heathrow Express. I will always use Heathrow Express because 15 minutes and I'll be in the center of London in the peak time. So it's the convenience that makes people really make the choice of diverting from using their own cars to use the public transportation system.
And is there a plan for Doha in that direction?
And that's the plan. I mean, the rail system, this is what does with connecting it with the bus system and connecting it with the systems that are available in Qatar.
Yeah, basically, like there are multi-level transportation plan available. People from metro to these tournament express buses, from the venue side, there will be shuttle buses. And basically, like all these public transport system will be kept probably faster than your car can reach it to the stadium.
Okay. Now I have another a question for Aspire, because I was very interested. Now, Aspire is quite an amazing installation. I mean, the whole facilities are really amazing. But being a resident of Qatar, it's still limited to certain category of people. I mean, just the sport. Is there any plan to spread this, what is developed in Aspire, to the whole community?
Aspire is the Academy of Excellence. Therefore, it's a national academy. So we select the player from other teams. We bring in Aspire. They have an education program. So they live there. They spend their time for school, time for training, and then. So that may that at least are selected athletes.
So it's a different plan. It's not a plan for health community.
Yes.
Even in the past, Aspire Active was a plan for ladies or men that would like to improve their training, even if are not at a high level. So, in general, Qatar is doing a lot for sports.
Yes.
And right now, I received a few days ago a communication that they are thinking to a wellness city. Doha could be a wellness city. And so it means that there is a lot of investment also in this direction. The country wants that people are more fit, also to avoid problems in the future of obesity and problem that will go at the top of the country in terms of economic involvement. Because of course, a healthy country, a healthy people will reduce the cost for medicine, is a good way to invest the money.
Point, because what I see through your presentation, it's really an accumulating the experience that need to be spread to the rest of the society, because what we see in the statistic in terms of obesity, high blood pressure, cholesterol, all this that comes from the weight can be tackled with sport. Yeah.
Absolutely. With education, nutrition, education is really an important thing. And also for sports. It's 8 years that I'm living here. Now I'm starting to see a lot of kids on the bike. In the past, it was impossible to see. Now the unbelievable, fantastic park here with pitch of tennis, basketball, and ball. So this is the road. Go build facilities that even normal people, even kids can use. So let the kids go on the street. On the street, I mean in a place well organized. This is the first step, building the culture. From my point of view, there is another key point that Qatar should appoint it, is the education of healthy in the school. In the school, lots of school in Qatar not doing properly physical education. So the timing, the physical education is not enough. So you can reach a level of a healthy country in terms of people only if you create the culture when you are small.
Yes, absolutely. Totally agree with you. Now I might ask the last question when it comes, because Abu Mood Stadium was very interesting and the first one I see these adoptions of BIM in the whole design process. But my question is, it what standard or all the other designed stadium, are they using the same standard as you have used in Abu Mood, or how is it?
So it's all the same standard.
It's the same old stadium.
So it's LOD 300 level in terms of, and then LOD 350 for construction.
But are they using the UK standard, or is it?
It's mainly the UK standard, yes.
All
and internationalized. So actually, the standards here are some of the highest. I mean, we do projects all around the world. Standards here are some of the highest that we've experienced on projects, full stop. So they're pushing the boundaries here. But you know, the reality for us is, you think about it, we're here as the MEP engineers, sustainability engineers, etc., and all the other bits that we do. Structural engineers were in Germany. The architect was in Spain. The client's here. So actually what it allows you to do is collaborate a little bit more when you sometimes have some distances apart. Of course, you all come here and you have workshop meetings and collaboration, but actually when you're designing in disparate parts of the world, it really does help, because you can do live on the screen with the stuff and coordination. So, and then as you're designing, you don't have to have workshops, you can see the coordination and some of the issues. So, I mean, it's not should you do it, it's just you do it now. I mean, it's like CAD, you just get on with it. I mean, it's an extremely useful tool.
Absolutely.
But the standards here, I have to stress, are very, very high. And that's the likes of Ashgal and other organizations who are pushing those standards, and fair play to them.
If I may maybe be more specific, what is the BIM legacy in the project? I mean, after the project is delivered, people have used BIM, what is left in the country for people who are going to manage the building? And this is there any initiative in that sense?
So the principle of asset management is in the BIM model itself. It's on all the stadiums. The management of the stadiums is still to be worked out because we're 4.5 years away yet. But the facilities will have to be managed by a company or companies. They will have access to that BIM model and all the asset management that goes with it. So absolutely, it's part of our delivery as a designer to do that. Yeah. So I mean, again, the BIM model will go to wherever it's going to go in the world. So yeah, it's true.
Okay, we might open question for the floor for 2-3 questions if there is any. Yes?
Just one question. There's actually a big question mark in the air, which came from FIFA beginning of the year, to increase the teams, to increase from actually 32 teams to 48, which makes 50% increase of teams. The question as well to Engineer Jasmin, how does SC will cope with that? Because it was already reduced the amounts of stadiums which have been requested by FIFA. So now there's a question mark of increasing the teams, so it might be as well even to have more stadiums available. And maybe as well, question to Matthew is it possible to have more of these stadiums just pull out of the ground and have 2-3 more, for example, for the World Cup?
Thank you very much for the question. The simple answer to the question, the current agreement with FIFA is to have 8 stadiums built, and that's what we are committed to. If it takes something more than that, that's something definitely would be able to handle, but that's the current agreement with FIFA, is to have 8 stadiums to be built. Increasing the teams or reducing the teams is still the 8th number, is the number that is required by FIFA.
In answer to your question, which is a really interesting question, we have a design for that which is a 20,000 version, 25,000 version. We have a design for that which is a 60,000 and an 80,000 version. So, if required, we can do it, right? It's a bit like going to IKEA, right? You get it out of the box.
First of all, I have to appreciate presenters because of great presentations. In your presentation, my friend, who I don't know his name, has mentioned considerable points about heritage, cultural issues, and the religious policy. I have two questions. My question refers to cultural issues. I would like to know whether you have thought about the revolutionize the effects of new generations. Whether you have any special plans to design a new culture or to bring the heritage in order to represent it. My second question refers to the considerable influence of your project on Middle East era. Whether you have thought about the economical, cultural, or even political values or effects of your project on the Middle East era, or no, just it's a project to develop Doha or Qatar. I clearly need to know how you want to influence all surrounding countries, especially all leading countries who have leading roles in world negotiations. Thank you very much.
Maybe the first thing to answer, maybe the last thing that you talked about, is how we can really support or work with other countries. There is programs that I said that the Supreme Committee is working on, and it's live programs where we go to Pakistan and we go to other regions and we really work with people who love and are passionate about football, and we really support them and do a lot of really tournaments and things that would really develop the love of really practicing football. And that's already a live program that's happening. There are tournaments that are happening either for the workers. There are a lot of programs that's happening really to develop. It's not really in the time of the World Cup, but it's happening now until the World Cup is taking place. So there are a lot of programs that are supporting these kind of things. For respecting the culture, the local custom, the local culture, that's something that's really taken into consideration. But we need to understand that we're getting people from all over the globe, and we need to really understand the diversity that's going to happen when people coming in there. Therefore, there are fan zones and there are areas where it really gives that I would say, freedom for people to do what they are used to do when they are back in their home. So there would be a consideration, really a massive consideration for the cultural aspects that we have in the community.
Yeah, thank you very much for yes, that has been discussed several times, but this is when you do work up, you have people from all over the world.
I just wanted to add maybe
political aspect or the political angle to what's happening around us and what happens in there, and I'm really proud and really we admire that we are working in the Supreme Committee with colleagues working with us from nationalities like in Egypt, we work with colleagues coming from Saudi, working from colleagues coming from all the countries around the world, even though there might be some challenges happening. But we're still working with these people and respecting all people around the region. We wanted to really differentiate about what's the political issues happening, where we're really focusing and delivering an amazing sport event in Qatar, working with everyone around the world.